Надо все слушать. Стоп, не
слушай.
Okay, although some people missing, so let's start. So Sergei is having a second lecture now.
Good morning, everybody. So yesterday I showed that if you have arbitrary n equals 2 to the kinetic sigma model in 4 dimensions, its target space is hyperkähler space. And now you can ask, if you are given hyperkähler space, can you construct n equals to sigma model? The answer is yes, and basically just to construct sigma model, well, we have to pick a complex structure. Well, hyperkähler manifold has S2 space, well, infinitely many complex structures, which are entire two sphere, we just pick one complex structure, call it J3. Diagonalize it, because it's complex coordinates for that structure, and then because manifold is scalar, the metric is generated by Kähler potential. The Kähler potential is just our Lagrangian. So two other complex structures which form the quaternionic algebra together with J3. They are of diagonal matrices because of that. And actually, so these blocks of diagonal blocks are constructed in terms of Kähler metric and holomorphic to form and its complex conjugate. Actually, this guy, so which originally appeared in sigma model context, it's not, but just the inverse of holomorphic to form and G. G C B. So this object is defined on hyperkähler manifold. So, I mean, J1 and J2 are constructed in terms of inverse of holomorphic to form and this conjugate. This is Kähler metric. So, and the final ingredient we need for a sigma model is supersymmetry transformation law. Well, delta phi A is half D bar squared this guy, and this guy is defined this way. So, as a result, we have one-to-one correspondence between n equals 2 supersymmetric sigma models and hyperkähler manifolds. And, well, then you can ask, well, probably this is the end of story, because well, what else can we do? But the problem is that this language of n equals 1, when we formulate sigma models in n equals 1 superspace, we cannot generate hyperkähler manifolds. The idea is just to use the power supersymmetry in order to generate geometries. And for that, we have to invent new techniques. We have to look for techniques to construct sigma models in n equals 2 superspace. And people tried to do that in the early 80s and failed. And the reason for that was that people tried to construct sigma models in standard n equals 2 superspace. Well, parameterized by coordinates of Minkowski space and 8 Grassmann variables. And resolution was found in mid-80s, and right setting was found in mid-80s, and so crucial idea was to add extra bosonic dimensions. If you recall Zonio's construction I described last time, so central charge was interpreted as fifth bosonic variable. So it's a bosonic variable corresponding to extra bosonic dimension, non-compact. But that interpretation wasn't really useful because a central charge is model dependent and you can nothing basically do using data interpretation. But what was actually necessary, and that was realized by several people in the 80s, that you need to add to extend n equals to superspace by compact manifold, auxiliary manifold, which is 2C or CP1, and that it, well, this was done, well, this idea was put forward by three different groups, and so they gave different names to space. Rosley and Albert, Alerta Rosley and Albert Schwartz called it isothistor space. Dubna collaboration called harmonic superspace, and Stony Brook Stockholm collaboration called it projective superspace. So, well, there is difference between harmonic and projective superspace. This approach is paid in, well, in history of science, where they still live. And so both names, I am used. I mean, people with both harmonic superspace and projective superspace. But let me start first with Roger Rosley construction, who basically introduced that object in November 1982 at a conference in Zvenigar, the Soviet Union. So at that time, many people everywhere in the world were interested in one specific problem in n equals to supersymmetry. Well, the problem was to solve the constraints for n equals to supersymmetry in terms of, to solve constraints, like in famous solution in n equals to supersymmetry. And that was really a difficult problem, and conceptual idea, well, the first concept, well, so Rosley was the first who basically solved the problem. He realized the constraints for n equals to super animals as integrability condition. He didn't publish a paper, he just decided to present solution to non-trivial problem at the conference. I call this approach scientific suicide. There are no citations for this, for his preceding paper. I mean, originally it was published in Russian, and so this was, nobody paid attention to his work. It was second time in the in modern history when Moscow physics community failed to realize new fundamental idea. First time was supersymmetry. So people in Moscow simply just failed to realize the significance of supersymmetry. They pick up only after people in the West have started research on supersymmetry. So what was Rosley's work was concerned with superannules, but I'll speak, well, in the context I'm discussing, well, it's natural to present his approach in terms of Fayez-Sonius hypermulti. So Fayez-Sonius hypermulti, which I showed last time, today this constraint Q is a dynamical object, and it's constraint n equals to superfield. So what Rosley suggested, he suggested to add isotwister variable, complex isotwister to component a vector, non-vanishing, and so he used that object to construct new spin derivatives out of the derivatives of n equals to superfield. What is important is that V is commutative object. And anti-commutation relations for spin derivatives, you see the right-hand side of anti-symmetric in IG. So when we contract both sides is VI and VJ, right-hand side, the expressions in the right-hand side disappear. So these objects, curly D and curly D bar, they're just strictly anti-commutative. Means they are just derivatives, some graph on the direction. And now, so next just took Fayez-Sonius hypermultiplicated and also contracted it with V. And then, so the master constraints take very simple form. So it just, we end up with generalized chirality condition. So, and this is very much like situation in n equals 1 supersymmetry, when we have chiral supersymmetry. Now, so far I considered supersymmetry with central charge. From now on, I will be implicit only in multiplets with a zero central charge. Reason for that, this is using such multiplets, you can, such multiplets are most suitable for applications. So there is a way to generate central charge for massive multiplets. From now on, central charge will be always zero. And instead of, if you remember notation I introduced last lecture, then in the case of vanishing central charge, instead of ball derivatives, just use ordinary derivatives. Now, Fayez-Sonius multiplet, Fayez-Sonius multiplet obeyed this nice constraint. And now we can introduce more general multiplets. You can introduce a new family of shell multiplets obeying similar constraints. What we do, because this Curie derivative strictly anti-commute, we can introduce superfields parameterized by superspace variables z and v, either sister and maybe its conjugate. And then, so we require such field, such superfields to be annihilated by Curie D's. Now, if you look at these constraints, they do not change if there is scale V, because derivatives are linear in V. So it is natural to work with such superfields which only scale under rescaling of V. So let me impose some additional condition on our superfield on phi. So I require phi to be homogeneous and V and V bar. So when we scale V and V bar, phi is required to scale. So we sum weights n plus and minus, such that the sum should be integer. Integer, well, we need integer, but just when we just go around zero, and come back, nothing should change. So, okay, in fact, we can get rid of a second scale factor. So the point is that this combination V dagger V, so I view V pi as a common vector and V dagger as rho vector, so V dagger V is just contraction. So V dagger is V conjugate I. So V take V is just V I have conjugate times P, and just positive number. V is required to be non-vanishing. So I can divide by this combination. It's all right. And therefore, I can stick my I don't lose anything if I deal with superfields that scale only, which are inert under the rescalings of V bar. So you see, in the whole picture, the constraints and superfields involve V, but nothing changes when we scale V, and it means that V is defined up to the Sicilian transformation. Therefore, V parameterizes a CP1. So, superspace that we end up with is n equals 2 superspace across S2. So, Rosley and Albert Schwartz called it isotwister. In my opinion, this is most natural name. But this name just didn't stay. It's forgotten. It's gone. Basically at this point, Rosley stopped. I don't understand the reason for that, but I believe that he had some feeling of frustration. Nobody paid attention. So 2 years later, they appeared harmonic superspace approach. So Rosley introduced, realized n equals to superamines, constraints for n equals to superamines as integrability conditions. So he introduced new multiplayers, but he didn't construct models. So, fully fledged approach appeared in 1984 in Dubna, not far from Moscow, but nothing appeared in Moscow. And what, you remember that V was defined after equivalence relation, like in quantum mechanics. In quantum mechanics, states are rays in Hilbert space. Instead of dealing with rays, we can just work with normalized wave functions. So what these people did, they just they use this equivalence relation to introduce normalized isotvisor. They call them harmonics. So a normalized isotvisor, actually, easy to see that they parameterize elements of a system. That's why harmonics. And so when we work with normalized isotvisors, we still have remaining equivalence relation left. So we can rescale our harmonics by phase factor. And so with such equivalence relation, harmonics parameterize SU2, which is Coase's space SU2 over U1. Now, so Rosley work with such superfields. So either these are superfields of wave n. I forgot to say that this parameter n, so now instead of dealing with isotvisor superfields, Gigas suggested to work with harmonic superfields. So for that basically, well, because phi only scales under the scaling of V, we can switch to, well, basically, we can restrict dependence of our superfields harmonics only. And then harmonics are defined modular phase transformations, and harmonic superfield must have been constraint. And it must have definitely one charge. Definitely one charge in this. So when we apply phase transformation to harmonics, also a few scales. And what is great about this approach? Well, here we can apply full power of harmonic analysis into sphere. So we have Fourier analysis of our fields in into sphere. So it's easy to construct your theory in this setting. Now the fields, harmonic superfields, are required to be smooth fields over the sphere. So physical multiplets are described in terms of harmonic superfields, which are required to be smooth kinds of fields over the sphere. Now, okay, we have kinematics, we have multiplets, but we need action principle to construct models. Action principle is quite simple to construct a supersymmetric action. We need harmonic superfield of wave 4. And then it can be shown that the following object is supersymmetric action. It doesn't change under supersymmetric transformation. So L is our Lagrangian. So d2 mu is just standard measure for S2 written in isotvisor notation. So this measure, well, just is given here in terms of V, but we can introduce a complex. Vi is homogeneous. Vi homogeneous coordinates for S2. We can introduce inhomogeneous coordinates for S2. So zeta. And then it's easy to see that this measure written in terms of zeta is this. This is standard measure for S2. And now final ingredient. So this fourth order spinner operator This operator, well, instead of writing this operator, one can just write integral over four Grassmann variables. Four Grassmann. Well, so harmonic superfields depend, well, they're annihilated by four Grassmann, by four spinner coordinates. Total number of spinner coordinates is eight. It means a harmonic superfield depends on four variables. So basically, what, well, they live on some subspace of superspace. And what this operator does is basically just, this is integral over subspace, magnetic subspace of full superspace. So, well, the property of Bayesian integral, Grassmann integral, is that integration is equivalent to differentiation. So integral over Grassmann variables is the same as partial derivative with respect to Grassmann. So it's easy to prove that this is indeed supersymmetric action. I don't have time. If you are interested in technical details, I can.
Is there any simple reason?
So you
you integrate over half space, but you are saying it's invariant on the full supersymmetry.
Yeah, reason very simple. Very, very superfield. So it's always epsilon I. Qi plus epsilon bar I Q bar I. Supercharges. Supercharges commute with derivatives. So when we vary the action, so we vary Lagrangian, supercharges go through because this operator delta to the minus 4 is constructed in terms of derivatives. But then you see it, so we just pull this operator to the left. And because we switch off all Grassmann variables, we can replace Qs by derivatives. So this this turns into minus epsilon I di plus epsilon bar d bar I. But now we can decompose each derivative here with respect to curly d's or such. Yeah? So they form of complete basis. But now this object anti-commute, so del and del bar are strictly anti-commute. If we get del bar here, del or del bar, we get zero because we get product of five objects. But if we get curly D annihilates Lagrangian. We can pull curly D through to hit Lagrangian, and then it's zero. But on the way, we produce space-time partial derivatives. Because curly D and del bar, so anti-commutator, is partial derivatives. Partial derivatives, well, because we do integral over space-time, they don't contribute. That's the reason for this. So that's all I wanted to say about harmonic superspace. It's very powerful approach. It's the best approach for to do quantum superelements. So all calculations in all well just supergraph calculations in n equals to superelements. Well, just practically all calculations are performed in this approach. But in my opinion, it's not. The best setting for sigma models, although, I mean, say, Ivanov would argue with me. And I believe that for sigma model applications, so projective approach is better suited. And the reason for that it has direct contact with n equals 1 formulation discussed last time. So what is projective superspace? It's the same superspace.
One more question about this delta minus 4. Can you characterize it in some way? Is it a unique operator of degree 4 with some properties?
Yeah.
What are the properties?
So this should be, I mean, this operator, I mean, we should start with integral over analytic subspace of superspace, and then rewrite it in terms of derivatives. So, I mean, So you just read all that operator. You do not postulate. So starting point is integral over analytic subspace. I don't have time to define that. So so then we just read all that property. So we just get it.
But I think it's like you are doing contour integral in superspace, right?
Yeah, so probably this is analogy. It should correspond to some kind of cycle. But okay.
But you see, I mean, Grassmann integral, you can only think of it as integration over closed contour.
I think he's just saying that that is a section of some very similar. When you integrate out, you get you only integrate the odd guys, you just get an actual section of the canonical bundle of the reduced supermanifold. Is now just a manifold, and this is a differential operator. Integration happens to be a differential operator.
Yeah, sure, but I was wondering whether there is a characterization of this differential operator, which would mean that, okay, I can possibly write many differential operators of degree 4, but only this one is a good one.
Right, so there's a unique one, which is in Beresingian integration from sections of the Beresingian to sections of the canonical bundle.
So what you should keep in mind that in harmonic setting all superfields, including Lagrangian, are smooth tensor fields over two spheres. So in projective setting, they depend both on U plus and U minus, or they depend on either twister V and its conjugate. In projective setting, they say we are interested only in multiplets that are holomorphic in V. There is no V-bar dependence. So they like complex analysis, yeah? So there is no dependence on V-minus. And so it's a projective multiplet, just either twister multiplet that depends on V only. So there is no dependence on V-bar. And so such superfields are called projective. And one more important difference from harmonic setting. There is no need to require projective multiplet to be globally defined. It may have singularities. And so in harmonic setting, multiplets must be globally defined because we integrate over entire two sphere. But here the action principle is integral, just contour integral. And therefore, our superfields have to be global, well defined only along the contour. And they may have singularities outside. And they have to have singularities outside for the action to be non-zero. Because this is, so if this object is holomorphic, the integral is zero. There must be poles somewhere. Otherwise, the integral doesn't exist. So what the only difference from harmonic setting, we just have one contour integral. So in harmonic approach, we actually have two contour integrals. You can think as just, so this product is double contour. Now, this operator is almost the same with the only difference. We need second either twister, U. That is, doesn't appear, well, in definition of multiplets. So this either twist, the only condition on U is that it is linearly, well, U and V are linearly independent. So this contraction is unmatched. But otherwise it is arbitrary. And then you can show, using the properties of projective multiplets and Lagrangian has a 2 now. So you can show that nothing depends on U. So when we just change U arbitrarily, but to stay linearly independent of V, the action doesn't depend on U. So it's kind of topological. I don't want to use this term, but so this is the action principle. It is, well, it can be shown that the action is supersymmetric, and the action is constructed in terms of way two multiple. So we now we have a machine. So we can just describe our theory in terms of some projective multiplets. We can use them to construct Lagrangian. Lagrangian should be composite object of V2, and then we automatically have action, so we just, we can, we have really, well, just end up with machine to generate supersymmetric models. Okay, I have to say a few words about properties of trajective multiplets. So I introduce them as functions of V, and V is in homogeneous variable for CP1. Instead of working with V, we can work with inhomogeneous, complex inhomogeneous coordinates for CP1. Well, so it's in one chart, so we, CP1 can be covered by two charts. I can always restrict my consideration to one chart because the action involves contact integral. And say the point that does not belong to the chart can be always chosen to be outside of the point. So all analysis can be performed in one chart. So all multiplets can be reformulated as function of zeta because they only scale when we rescale V. So instead of, well, we can associate with each projective multiplet a new object, which is a function of, well, holomorphic function of zeta. Well, this new object is proportional to the original. And this coefficient, well, relating them depends on specific multiple. But when we, in terms of new object, well, new object, we can expand in powers of zeta. So in general, we end up with Lorentz series. Sometimes, so these limits are finite numbers. What is important that they are supersymmetric invariants. So when we perform supersymmetric transformation, so P and Q doesn't change. So each coefficient here is n equals to superfield. Now ordinary superfield. So projective multiplet is collection of ordinary n equals to superfields. And supersymmetry, like a ring of power, it just binds them together. So all coefficients in this series. Now projective multiplets are based on analytic conditions. And these conditions can be rewritten in terms of this coefficient, in terms of coefficients QK, ordinary superfields. And then if you do that, so we obtain these relations. And these relations, you see, I mean, we hit our superfield with secondary, with derivative corresponding to second Grassmann variable. And this can be expressed as derivative with respect to first Grassmann variable. So there are two sets of Grassmann variables. And so Q1, Q2, and their conjugate. And what the analytic conditions tell us that dependence of Q on theta 2 and its conjugate is completely determined in terms of dependence of Q on the first Grassmann. On the first set of Grassmann variables. So it's like this Poisson-Yersonius hypermultiplet. If we restrict, if we just project to n equals 1 superfield, a superspace, if we restrict dependence of Q to that on theta 1, theta bar 1, so we keep all deformation, we do not lose anything. Now, important property of projective multiplet. So in n equals 1 supersymmetry, we have chiral superfields. When we conjugate chiral superfield, it's no longer chiral. It obeys different constant. It's anti-chiral. So in n equals 2 supersymmetry, we can have a superfield which are both linear, projective and real. So we can introduce real structure in the space of analytic, in the space of projective multiplets, this structure is called a Smile conjugation. So we can start with arbitrary projective multiplet, so it obeys such conditions. Then we complex conjugate. Of course, we end up with multiplet with no longer projective because it depends on zeta 1. But now you can see that if we replace zeta bar here by minus 1 over zeta, so this mapping on CP1 then zeta goes to minus 1 over zeta bar is antipodal mapping. Yeah? So when we accompany a complex conjugation by antipodal mapping, we end up with multiplet with again project. And so so this operation is called smile conjugation. It preserves structure of multiplets, and in particular we can introduce real projective multiplets. Real projective multiplets so have this property. So coefficients with positive and negative labels are related to each other. So in particular Lagrangian in our action must be real multiplet in order for the action to be positive. Now, so far, the action was given in terms of the two Lagrangian, it was function of V, but we can also formulate the action in terms of zeta value, like I did for before for multiplet. So for that, I can just assume that North Pole is outside of integration contour. So then I relate L2 to, so I have to introduce this object. I said that this object depends, so definition of Q, this new object, Q depending on zeta depends on specific multiplet. For the Lagrangian, well, coefficient relating original multiplet and that depending on zeta is, well, coefficient is used to choose in this form. So then L, this function of zeta, is a real aspect of smart information. So, I do that and then plug this into my action and I make special choice for you. Remember I said that the action doesn't depend on you. I can choose you any way I like. The only condition on you, it must be independent of me. So, and in the north chart, I can always choose you to be 1, 0. So, this is the action we end up. So what remains of this operator is derivative with respect to first Grassmann variable and derivative with respect to second Grassmann variable. But I would like everything to be expressed in terms of derivative with respect to first Grassmann variable. But I do have an elliptic condition. I can just switch where I replace d bar by this. Because dependence on the second set of Grassmann variables is completely determined in terms of this with respect to first set of. So I make use of an elliptic condition, and then there will be extra power of 1 over zeta squared that cancel zeta and numerator. So we will d1 squared, d bar 1 squared, and this is actually with some coefficient, and this is what we obtain by integrating over n equals 1 superspace. And now we project to n equals 1 superspace. So we started with the action that is manifestly n equals 2 supersymmetric. But now the action is formulated entirely in n equals 1 superspace. There is no dependence on second set of Grassmann variables left. So we have theory formulated in terms of n equals 1 superfields, and we know that it is of n equals 2 supersymmetric. Before I give you several models, I have to describe some properties, important properties of projective multiplets. So there exist projective multiplets that terminate. So Lorentz series terminate from below or from above. And in such case, the lowest coefficients obey spatial constraints. Analytic constraints involve both d2 and d1, but if the series terminate from below, then the lowest component is n cosine chiral sufficient. Because yeah, this guy is not there. And next to lowest component is complex linear sufficient. And so similar properties hold for coefficient of P on top. Now this very special case that then Q and P related this way. And then there are only three components. Lowest component is chiral, highest top component is anti-chiral, and in the middle is real linear. Real linear is superfield that annihilated by both D squared and D bar squared. Now let me give you a few multiplets that are useful for sigma model constructions. So one family of multiplets is real auto n multiplets. You can consider complex when instead of 2n you have just any positive integer, but then such object describes two hypermultiplets. To have single hypermultiplet, we need just so even parameter. So essentially we start with object field. We can think of just superfield with 2n indices, completely antisymmetric and annihilated, well, obeying the constraints that just nature translation of that of those describing Fayez-Solomon's hyper.
What's the difference between even and odd? Why do we need
I can impose reality condition only in the case of even weight. So if this weight is odd, then a multiplet is complex. So basically it describes two hypermultiplets. But if I want to have just one hyper, I need that condition. So from point of view of n equals 1 supersymmetry, lowest component is chiral, next to lowest is complex linear. Higher components are unconstrained objects until we end, so H naught is real unconstrained, and until we reach, next to top and top components. Next to top component is antilinear, and top components are antichiral. So special case is O2 multiplet. It's not hypermultiplet, it's tensor multiplet. So the component in between is a real linear superfield. So for these models, we can construct more general supersymmetric action. Lagrangian is a function of eta, say for tensor multiplet, and in general there may be explicit dependence on zeta. And this action was first written down by Calhet, Lindstrom, and Rochick in 1984. So basically, you can just take any function, any homomorphic function of two variables, replace one variable by this eta multiplet. So compute this, and you end up with supersymmetric T. Or in case of O to N multiplets, you can just take any function depending on a homomorphic function of its variables, compute this action, and then you have supersymmetric T. And now, these models formulated in terms of tensor multiplets and O to N multiplets, they lead to sigma models, but not the most general ones. The more general sigma model can be constructed in terms of arctic multiplets. What is arctic multiplet? Arctic multiplet is is described by a series that terminates only from the low. It's described by Taylor series. And its mild conjugate, is described by a series that terminates from one. Spatial Lorentz. So multiplet, here we have infinite series of n equals 1 superfields. lowest component is chiral circuit field. Next to lowest component is complex linear. And then we have infinite series of unconstrained objects. They are auxiliary circuit fields. We need them to for super signal just to complete multiply. And then the most general action we can write down in terms of polar multipliers is this. So Lagrangian, well, is a real, Lagrangian is a real projective multiplier as from point of complex analysis, it's function of epsilon, the conjugate holomorphic function, and maybe explicit dependence on zeta. So far, well, it, so far it's just simple because here we have a lot of work to do in order to end up with reasonable theory. We have, first of all, we have to do the counter integral. Second, we have to eliminate infinite set of auxiliary circuit fields. So I'll come to that point. But if we manage to do that, then we have a sigma model. And actually, I'm going to show that the most general sigma model can be described, can be deduced from such Lagrangians. So Lagrangians are generated by arbitrary holomorphic functions.
So, slightly confused about the invariance of this arctic multiplets. I thought this all of your multiplets were objects that were globally defined over this coordinate z, and you were just taking some series expansion.
No, I mean, I said the projective multiplets are not required to be globally defined onto sphere.
So in this particular case, this one is only defined on the formal name over a point.
So arctic multiplet is holomorphic outside of North Pole. Antarctic is holomorphic outside of South Pole.
But your integral was invariant when you considered it over the whole CP1. So.
But the integral is done over, well, you see, I integrate over contour, and singularities are outside of the contour. So this is the beauty of projective setting. You are allowed to have singularities, and you need singularities. Otherwise, the action is zero. So what is Arctic and Antarctic form polar multiplier. I'd like to say this is Nordic terminology introduced by people from Nordic countries. This multiplet can be used to describe charge hypermultiplets. And why charge? Because we have phase symmetry. So this phase symmetry is not there for real O2N multiplets. And then we have ring structure in the space of such multiplets. As I said, so far it's just simple because there are two, we can write this Lagrangian, but we have to just extract useful information from it. And to extract useful information, two technical and very challenging steps have to be performed. I mean, just we have to do the contour integral and integrate auxiliaries. But suppose we can do that. So what, just let me show. Let's assume that, well, just take physics point of view. We keep going until we face the world. So we start with most general. So this procedure I'm going to describe it was called generalization transformation. So this is a most general sigma model formulated in terms of arctic multiplier. So Lagrangian is a function of arctic multiplier, the slime conjugates, Antarctic, and there may be explicit zeta dependence. You can think of explicit zeta dependence, like in quantum mechanics, if we have explicit time dependence, so our system is in external field. You can always think of explicit zeta dependence if it's present as, so just some presence of some background forces. Well, it's probably not good. But anyway, so suppose we can do the contour integral. So then we end up with field theory in Eric Lagrange superspace. So that theory depends on chiral superfields, complex linear superfields, their conjugates. These are physical fields. They become constraints. I mean, they describe
So hypermultiplet is described in terms of such positions. But we also have an infinite pair of auxiliary distributions. They are auxiliary because they do not obey any constraints. The equations of motion are algebraic. So algebraic non-linear equations. So in principle, if our Lagrangian obeys suitable condition, then so we can solve these equations, algebraic equations, to express this infinite set of auxiliaries in terms of physical variables. So if we are smart enough, then we end up with Lagrangian formulated in terms of our physical variables only. And this, because we started with supersymmetric theory, the final action is also supersymmetric. Okay. So what can you say? Well, we wanted to just, we know that because it was it is sigma modulus n equals to supersymmetric, the target space is hyperkelly. But this is not yet hyperkelly potential, because Lagrangian is hyperkelly potential only if our theory is formulated only in terms of chiral superfluid. But here we have both chiral and complex linear. So we have to perform one more, we have to take care of one more step. We have to dualize complex linear superfields in two chiral superfields. And now I have to tell you about two different descriptions of a scalar multiplet. So if you study Weisbacher book only, which is very short and very nice, but it, after having studied it, you just still have a lot of questions. So in that book, they describe only one multiplet that can be used to describe, to realize a scalar multiplet, chiral superfield. But there is one more multiplet realization of a scalar multiplet. It's called non-minimal. And that multiplet is realized in terms of complex linear superfield. So chiral superfield are based linear constraints. So it is annihilated by d bar. Complex linear is annihilated by d bar squared. So here I have sigma bar, it is annihilated by d squared. But these objects describe essentially the same free multiplet. Because the equation of motion for the first object, the equation of motion we read off from the free action, is this. And the equation of motion for complex linear superfield, its free action is. I mean, it's first derivative of sigma bar. You see that what was off-shell constraint for the first multiplet becomes equation of motion for the second, and vice versa. So on-shell, we have the same dynamical content. So you see that here we have two different off-shell realizations of for minimal multiplet. And such realizations are dual to each other. Well, so non-minimal multiplet was introduced by Jim Gates, Warren Siegel. And so duality between chiral and complex linear multiplet appeared first in a conference paper of Bruno Zumin. So these two theories are said to be dual. Duality means just they're related by some Legendre transformation. So instead of dealing with this action or the second, we can introduce a first order action. So we replace, for example, gamma by complex unconstraint and introduce terms with Lagrange multipliers. If we vary with respect to psi is chiral, gamma becomes complex linear. And then these two terms disappear and we end up with the action for complex linear. But instead we can integrate out gamma. So we can consider the equation of motion for gamma. And then gamma becomes function of psi. Gamma bar becomes function of psi. Yeah. And so we can eliminate gamma and gamma bar, and we end up with a chiral action. So two theories, by playing different games, we end up with second theory or with the first. And this can be extended to sigma models. So we can start with our sigma model action, formulated in terms of chiral superfields and complex linear, and we can dualize complex linear superfields. So we replace a sigma by complex unconstrained, we introduce terms with Lagrange multipliers,
psi is now chiral superfield, and this is equivalent to the original friction, because when we when we consider the equation of motion for psi, gamma becomes complex linear, so this contribution disappears and we are back to the friction. But instead we can integrate, we can consider the equation of motion for gamma, the algebraic equation. And if Lagrangian is good enough, we can, well, use these equations to eliminate gamma and gamma bar. And then our action E becomes function of phi and phi bar. It is formulated purely in terms of chiral superfields, and this is n equals to supersymmetric theory. Therefore, Lagrangian we end up with is a hyperkeller potential. So, so all this works provided we can do the contour integral and provided we can eliminate auxiliary fields. But now, so next step, I'd like to show that actually, so that model, so this model, polar multiplet model, really corresponds. I mean, if so. Most general n equals 2 supersymmetric sigma models are encoded in here. So, and for that, do I have time to? Yeah, I can do it. So, that was the original model. But then, after several technical steps, we arrived at that formulated in terms of chiral superfields. And now you can ask questions. What can we learn about second supersymmetry of dual action from off-shell supersymmetry of the first action? And this question was addressed recently with my notes. So let me just show you, what supersymmetry tells us. That actually we can extract non-trivial information and by playing supersymmetry game, and that this action indeed can be used to derive most general sigma model and therefore most general hyperkeller metric at least locally. So this is symmetry of the original off-shell symmetry of original action. So I'm interested in second supersymmetry. So I just take the supersymmetry parameter on the second component to be nonlinear. And I project this transformation to n equals 1 superspace. So when I project to n equals 1 superspace, supercharges can be replaced by covariant derivative. Multiplet is projective, so second derivatives are related to first derivatives. And so I can express everything in terms of derivatives in n equals 1 superspace. So, and then this supersymmetry transformation law amounts to an infinite series of transformation laws, so epsilon naught, epsilon 1, and so on. What I need is just a first line, because in the end I eliminate all, well, epsilon 2, epsilon 3 are derivatives. They get eliminated. So, the final action is constructed in terms of epsilon naught and epsilon 1. And what you see, transformation of epsilon naught, which is phi, is epsilon 1, which is sigma. The transformation of epsilon 1 involves epsilon 2. And epsilon 2 is a function of physical fields when we eliminate all auxiliaries. So when we, for the action construct, well, for the action formulated in terms of physical variables, well, transformation of sigma is just transformation given on previous slide, but now you see epsilon 2 becomes function of physical variables, and we do not know the function, because to determine this function, we have to do the contour function. Yeah? We have to eliminate that. We have to solve the equations of motion for the fields. But now just, okay, suppose it's still all right, let me just go to dual formulation. And so introduce Lijan about this first order action to construct Lijan transformation. And then I can show that the invariant supersymmetry of the original action is equivalent to the following supersymmetry transformation of first order action. So this unknown function epsilon 2 appears again in transformation of gamma only. Gamma now is complex unconstrained. But then we integrate out gamma. So we express gamma as a function of physical fields. And because first order action is invariant, as well, a dual action is also invariant. Because we just one field, we put one field on shell. So this guy is gone. Now we no longer need this function epsilon 2, which we do not know. And so we see that the dual action is invariant on transformation that are pretty simple. Right hand sides are, well, of delta phi and delta psi are constructed in terms of derivatives of hyperkeratotic energy. And I can rewrite I can combine two equations into single equation if I introduce canonical symplectic matrix. Now we should go back to the first lecture. In the first lecture, I showed that a most general n equals 2 sigma model formulated in n equals 1 superspace is invariant under second supersymmetry that involves the inverse of this holomorphic to 4, this up. And, well, in general, it just 2 4. But in our case, in the previous slide, this omega AB is just constant matrix. So, for the model, for our model, omega is J, and holomorphic to form is also J, because this guy and that guy are inverse to each of each other, is minus. So it means that in coordinate system, complex coordinates, spatial system of complex coordinates, phi and psi, holomorphic symplectic to form has very simple form. It is given in Darboux. Well, so these variables are Darboux coordinates for the model. And now, basically, now, so it's, I well just I can confirm my claim that basically, so this model introduced really allows to describe arbitrary a sigma model. So say we can start. So if we reconstruct this action starting from arbitrary hyperkeratotic manifold, for that we need to pick out complex structure J3 to realize hyperkeratotic manifold as K1 respect to J3. Then we have to introduce Darboux coordinates for this holomorphic to form. And then we can write S dual. After that, we can perform inverse Lejeune transformation. And we end up with this action. But, this procedure does not tell you anything about the original of shell Lagrangian. And this is actually a very nice construct, except for spatial case that you will discuss later in lecture notes. And this very special, very nice construction due to Linsimirochik to rederive L starting from hyperkeratotic manifolds. So this Lagrangian, offshore Lagrangian, is actually a generating function of some symplectic morphism. Sorry, I just don't have time left, and I just 5 minutes. So thank you.
Any questions for Sergei?
So, if you get rid of all the auxiliary fields, and you're left with a Kähler potential with the any 2-to-1 Kähler, any 2-to-1 superfield, Kähler superfield, how do you know necessarily that the kinetic term you get in this will be positive definite?
There should be some restriction on Lagrangian, definitely. Maybe indefinite.
So
So you mean you start from an arbitrary state, active
law. It may be degenerate.
So you may not get
yeah,
a
yeah. hypothetical. You may get something else.
Any further questions? Okay, if not, let's thank Sergey again. So I'm just reminded that the next lecture will be at 1 o'clock here.